everyone. Thank you for coming. My name's Eric, as Sarah just said, manager of front-end platforms at ASICS Digital. And today we're going to be talking about ASICS's step forward, embracing composable architecture. So making everything more performant, flexible, agile, to drive us further into the future. So the agenda for today, foundational tech, our humble beginnings, where we started, where we're moving away from, and then moving into Shoe Finder. How we took all of these foundational technologies and kind of combined them to start in order to figure out where we're going next. And then finally moving into composable architecture, which is the bulk of what I'm going to talk about, how we've leveraged Vercel, a new CMS, all sorts of different technologies and actually made this work. And then finally moving on into the future and micro frontends and where we ultimately want to go. So jumping in, initial stride, there's a lot of shoe puns and running puns in here. Good luck, everyone. Where did we start from? We have Salesforce Commerce Cloud on one side and one ASICS on the other side. So Salesforce Commerce Cloud covering 4 different regions, 27 locales, really all over the place. And along with that, leveraging basically everything else that Salesforce has to offer. So Marketing Cloud, Service Cloud, MuleSoft, all the other clouds and softs that I can't remember. And then on the one ASIC side, we have a bunch of React applications that we've built over the years to really build up that React bench internally, but also to be more agile and to be able to drive things at the scale that we want to. So we had Salesforce, we had React. What happened? We built a product called Shoe Finder. And we built it using PWA Kit, which in this case is Salesforce's version of them allowing us to leverage React within the Salesforce environment still. So there's a lot of benefits to using it, just like many other platforms that are very integrated in the same way. We have the project templates that come with it, so it helps you stand up a storefront very quickly. And then the integration with the Salesforce APIs, obviously, because it is Salesforce building it after all. And then finally, the managed runtime. So giving us the CI/CD pipelines that we need without having to burden our DevOps engineers with another system they now need to manage. So what did we learn? What went well? What didn't go well? The pros really were the CI/CD pipeline, their managed runtime. We were able to stand up a whole bunch of environments, get Shoe Finder stood up in a very short amount of time, and ultimately launch this across the globe. The cons were that it's a very rigid platform, so we're kind of beholden to their upgrade cycles. If they want us to use Node 18, for example, that's what we have to use. And in some cases, the backwards compatibility just wasn't there for us. And then finally, the learnings. I'd say this is really the core of what we learned and what we've been building on from that point on, which was we've learned that we can inject a React app inside of a Salesforce site when you probably shouldn't be able to do that. I'll get into it, but it's a long story. It complicates routing, state management, SEO, all of that just kind of gets in the way. But ultimately, it does work. So we move into our hybrid transition and where we did take some of this learnings of, should you actually inject a React app inside of Salesforce? Yes, maybe you should. It was kind of like changing the engine of the car while it's running. We have actually done this quite a few times across other systems, and it's very hard, it's very nerve-wracking, but if you pull it off, you then have a very seamless transition from one tech stack to the other. So this is our crazy new tech stack that we're working on, but it's still very intricate. We're combining technologies that are and are not supposed to work together. Remember how I said React app inside of a Salesforce site? Yeah, exactly that. And if you read that subhead that I'm not going to read right now because I will butcher it, that's exactly what we're doing. It is just as confusing as it sounds, but it is actually pretty simple. So starting off, the CMS. We chose Content Stack for one very core reason, and that was because it allows you to create a whole bunch of stacks, as they call it, hence the name, And with the regionality differences that we have, it's very beneficial for us to be able to allow, for example, the US, Europe, and Japan to create their own content and not trample over anyone else. So that was definitely a huge benefit for us. We can then create templates and all sorts of things that these regions can use. But then we still have a lot of the security implications that we need to take care of. So content, people copy-paste stuff all the time, as we all know. So we're able to take the rich text editor content that people have inputted content into and turn it into JSON. And from there, we can either parse it as text, or if it is a certain type of attribute that we actually want to recognize, we can parse that as well. This kind of gets around the issues of someone inserting a script tag, and all of a sudden you have people that shouldn't be in the deep depths of your site now there, to just display the text instead. And then the core part, as it is with the four different regions that we work with, is that everyone updates at a very different content cycle. And especially with the actual time zone difference, we can't all be sitting here in the US or in Europe managing all of this. So with the content update webhooks, we're able to take a webhook from content stack, push it to Vercel, and have that content either regenerate or create the new stuff. This all kind of goes into the headless side of things, which is what we really wanted, considering we are moving into a headless hybrid stack, where we're able to now separate the content management piece from the content delivery. Content managers don't need to know how the site is updated, and we don't really care what the content is that they are updating. We just care that we're able to display it as quickly as possible, which I think as of right now, with deploy cycles and everything going on, is probably somewhere in the range of 5 to 10 minutes. And then finally, the extensibility. So ASICS, we're everywhere. We have so many unique use cases that we need to account for. So what do we do? Well, you have the stacks, helps us right out of the gate. But then we can extend content stack with custom plugins that we've created. And then finally, again, it integrates well with other platforms, like Vercel. Which brings me to the next topic, Vercel and Next.js. Why did we choose it? What's going well, everything around it, basically. So it comes with performance in mind. So server-side rendering, as we all know, it's great. Content is generated. We just shove a whole bunch of HTML to the client. We're off to the races. Along with that, we get the Vercel functions. So if we need to stand up something, but we don't want to stand up a whole backend around it, think of, let's say, a form that requires some sort of authentication with Salesforce. Well, we're able to do that by just standing up a Vercel function that will probably take us maybe a half hour, hour, depending on how difficult that is. And then server-side rendering and incremental site rendering. So in some cases, we only want to re-render some parts of the page. But in other cases, we know the content is static. Think of like a blog post, for example. And then the ability to move from the pages router to the app router incrementally. So as of right now, the way it stands with ASICS is we have a lot of content on the site, but it's still inside of that Salesforce frame. So we can't use the app router because we can't take over the whole page. Once we take over the whole page, then we can actually listen to the URL and understand what's going on. But until then, we need Salesforce to basically inform Next.js of what's the next content to inject in there. So I'll get to that in a second. It's still a little weird, but we've been able to basically take all of this and build a rich integration with the existing React bench that I was talking about earlier. Our developers, they know exactly what they need to know, and then there's a few of the gotchas and nuances that you just need to know when it comes to Next.js. So from there, we're able to take a few people actually sitting in the front here, and allow them to work in Next.js, but then understand a few of those nuances, like I said, like dynamic paths, things like that. The new routing structure, which is a bit different than a client-side rendered React app, and it just works. So 95% knowledge is already there. The other 5% you learn on the job. The straightforward CI/CD pipeline is, again, one of the greatest things ever. We currently have somewhere around 24 or 25 preview environments, along with the production environments that go with it. And it's great knowing that, again, our DevOps engineers don't need to do anything around this. They can just basically allow us to route URLs correctly, and then they disappear and go off and do their own thing. And then finally, the file-based routing, which I still think is probably one of the greatest things that has come out of Next.js. There's no intricate routing system that you need to understand. As long as you structure your files correctly, that's exactly how the user is going to route there. Putting it all together, so how does all of this stuff that I just said actually make it onto the page? Well, it's kind of messy, but it's a messy that is actually pretty manageable. So what we do when the user hits a page, let's say, for example, a blog page, purely content for the most part, we make a request out to Vercel, and we get a deconstructed Next.js app. And inside of that, I don't know if it's super visible up there, but we get the head tag, the body tag, some meta content, and a layout. So we take the body, and we put it in the body ISML template in Salesforce Commerce Cloud. We take the head content, we put it in the head. Surprise. And then the meta content, we actually generate on the fly. And the reason for this is we still want to keep that SEO intact for search engines to be able to crawl this content so that we still get value out of it, which was an issue that we weren't able to solve with PWA kit because that was all still client-side rendered. And then finally, layout. So this is where it gets a little weird. It may be more of a unique case for us as we make this migration more incrementally. But basically what we're doing here is we're telling the app which parts of the page to take over or where to insert this content that is coming from Next.js. So there we have, in this case, full. So we're taking over everything between the header and footer, and we basically just replace all of that content. In other cases, we have, for example, a PLP, where we might just create a single PLP that is some marketing content, or maybe a marketing banner at the top of the page. It really depends on which page we're on. And that's how we get hybrid composable. So, as I was saying, between the header and footer, that's exactly what we see here, where everything down to that promotional banner of get up to 20% off, that's all coming from Salesforce. Next.js knows nothing about it. Next.js doesn't care about it. Vercel doesn't. Content Stack doesn't. No one. That video, that's coming from Content Stack through Vercel, Next.js, and all of that, all the way down to the footer. If you go to the ASICS.com site right now, that's exactly the experience you're going to see. And for the developers out there, your dev tools will actually tell you that you are looking at a React app. Finally, home stretch, our micro frontend marathon, where we're going. So why do we want to use micro frontends? It's just complicating things, right? Kind of, but not really. It's actually making it so that in the future, it's a lot more resilient to any issues that come up or different teams being able to scale at a pace that is comfortable for them. So on the scalability side of things, some teams work faster than others. That's just how it is. A more marketing-focused team may be running a million A/B tests a week and also deploying multiple times a day. But if it's something more core to your product that is truly driving that revenue, so say checkout, where obviously if that goes down, everyone is in a very bad situation, those teams may move a little slower. So we're able to take all of these and separate them out into different micro front ends. And from there, if there's an issue on the homepage, it doesn't impact checkout. People can still go buy the latest Nimbus, and we still make money. But at the same time, that homepage team can now back out their changes or push new changes without affecting any of the other teams that are there. So this way, everything is much more siloed. It's much safer. But at the same time, the speed is there depending on which team wants to do what. On the reusability side, this is where it really depends on your product. In the case of ASICS, we do sponsor a lot of marathons, Olympics, you name it. And in some cases, we want to highlight a certain shoe or product. And that's where we're able to take a PDP, for example, and only tie it to checkout and not allow any of the surrounding experience. So that way, someone can show up to the starting line, buy a pair of shoes before they start the race. I don't know if it's going to be super helpful. Maybe for the next race it will. But they don't have to see any of the extra marketing flair around it, none of that. That's all probably contained within that booth anyways. And that way, you're creating a very strict and pointed campaign to get people to do what you want them to do. Now, how to make it work? It's all very technical. I'm not going to bore everyone with it. But really, there's two core models to this. One is route-driven, which is much simpler. It's more so used for dashboards, tabular data, things like that, where you're able to pass state between different pages just using your regular query parameters in the URL. And that way, it's also able to be bookmarked by the user so that they can come back exactly to that same experience. On the other hand, we have the central orchestrator model. And this is where it gets a lot more involved. So as opposed to the route-driven model, here you have a core app still that mounts and unmounts these micro frontends and then also provides it with the state that it needs, as well as allowing it to only update the state that it is allowed to update, as opposed to the route-driven model where you're probably using a global variable or a cloud database, something like that, where then you must kind of be very careful to make sure that no one is clobbering this state all of a sudden and your users are stuck in a weird spot. And that's where I think the micro front-end approach kind of starts to fall apart if you try to get too intricate with it using the route-driven model. And with that, thank you all so much.